Have you ever wondered how to make the best color palette for your UI designs? Over the last 5 years, I've been working for some of the biggest companies in the world, as well as with some small scale-ups and startups. And I've learned loads about the best way to make use of systems and design things in a systematic way, which will save you time in the long run. So in this video, I'm going to show you how to make a system for your UI colors using Figma and a tool called Leonardo. And stick around to the end where I'll show you what to do if you're working in a design system or on a product where colors have been used but a system hasn't been put in place. I'll show you how to get from that to something which is more refined and more systematic. So let's go. So, a quick summary. A color system is a way to have all of your UI palette defined upfront. So when you come to designing things, you're not making any guesses. You're not just grabbing the eyedropper tool and picking which colors would look best. You're choosing from a predefined list. If you don't do this in advance, you'll end up with a website or a product which uses loads and loads of really similar shades, but that are never exactly the same. And this makes your product feel inconsistent, and in turn, that means users or visitors to your website will lose confidence in your product. They'll trust it less. So lots of people, especially if you're coming into UX from a graphic design background, think that the way to do color palettes is to just find a set of 5 shades. So if you go to Cooler or Pinterest, you'll see loads and loads of 5 color swatches you can use for a theme. But you need more than 5 colors to design an interface. And this is a lesson I learned in refactoring UI, which I refer to all the time. There's a free excerpt of this book online, and it's the section about colors. And they give you an example of an interface which has been designed with just 5 colors. And hopefully you can see from this example that this is exactly why you need more than 5 colors. You can't do anything with just 5 shades. So on a real world website or app interface, you've got way more than just 5 colors. And the way to define these is using color scales. So you would start by defining a color scale for your main brand color, and then maybe a secondary or tertiary brand color. And then you'd do the same for a set of neutral colors. So that's basically black to white, all the different shades of gray. And some brands I've worked with have had 2 sets of neutrals. You'd have warm neutrals and then cooler neutrals. And then ideally you'd also have color scales defined for what we call semantic colors. So these are normally reds and greens, which are used for error and success states, and oranges for the warning states. And obviously with all of these, there's a lot of tinkering you can do. So if you're working on a science-y startup, maybe your greens are less foresty green and more pharmacy green. But this is kind of the goal that we're gonna get to. The standard way to describe these is to label them with numbers between 50 and 900. But I've seen people do color systems that go up to 1500. And my intuition for why we use 50 to 900 instead of 1 to 9 or 0 to 9 is that it means that there's loads of individual spaces in between each number. So say you don't want red 100 or red 200, but you want a shade which is somewhere in the middle. By labeling them in this way, it gives you the flexibility to go in and add a red 150, which is bang in the middle. And then you can subdivide up to 100 times or 99 times in between each of those shades. So that's why this convention is used. So there's loads of tools to help you go out and make color scales, but the best one I've used is one called Leonardo. So Leonardo is open source and it's used for creating adaptive color palettes based on color contrast. So you can find it at leonardocolor.io, and I'm gonna jump in and show you how to use it. So here you can see we start out with 6 stops of a gray theme. So if we just go to this lightness stops tab here and press add a few times, we'll get 3 more stops, and that's what I like to use, up to 900. So if we go to distribute, you can see that there are different ways of spreading these stops out over the color scale. So you can either distribute by contrast ratios or by lightness. And then if we go back to color scales, we can add some other colors. So let's grab this next color we've created. And if we have a hex code or we've got a key color that we know we want to use, we can add it in here, and you can change the input from hex to RGB or HSL. So I'm just gonna do this nice bright red and save and go back. Let's give it a name actually, bright red. And then you can see it's applied that to the stops. There's lots of other useful stuff in this tool to do with chromaticity, lightness, and you can kind of see how it's distributed. And you can also extract colors from an image, which is really useful. But this is kind of the basic way to do it. So then what I like to do is click share, download it as SVG, and then drag this into Figma. So you can see it comes nicely formatted, but all of these are just raw shapes. So not that useful in Figma. So what I like to do now is if I ungroup this frame, so Command Shift G, and then I can just drag across all of those swatches, Shift to unselect the background, and then I've just got all of those grays. And then I can use some plugins to sort them, and then Command R to name them. And here you can see I'm using Figma's rename tool, so just Command R lets me rename them. And because I sorted those first, we've got those in a nice order. And then I can use a different plugin called Styler. So once we've got these as styles in Figma, there's a couple of other plugins we can use to help us out. So the Color Style Guide plugin lets us generate a color style page, and it gives us kind of this chip component, and then we get all of our styles well-defined on a page. We can also convert our styles to variables. So using this Styles to Variables plugin, we can create color variables. And then you'll see that all of our styles can be deleted because now we've got variables. So if you prefer working with variables or you're moving over from using styles to using variables in Figma, that's one way to do it. I'm not gonna go super deep into the difference between styles and variables in this video, but there's loads of resources out there. And I actually had an interview with Henry Daggett, who's the design systems lead at SocGen, and we talked loads about the benefits of variables last June. So go watch that interview if you're interested in hearing more about that. So that's a super basic overview of how to create your color ramps in Figma, either as styles or variables. Now there's lots of ways to do this. I've just shown you one way which I teach my students when I teach Figma classes at Experience House, and it's the way that's worked best for me. I've done this with loads of different brands over the years. Once you've done this, you can go further with design tokens. So what we did was just primitives, gray 50 to gray 900. But you can go further and say, this is a background surface color, or this is a button primary active color. And especially if you're using variables, you can map one variable to another variable. So any changes kind of cascade down. But I think if you're not doing that yet, this is the perfect place to get started. And at the beginning, I said I'd show you what to do if you're coming to a design system which is already in flight, or maybe you're taking over the UX design of a project which hasn't had a full-time designer on it beforehand, and there's just loads of these inconsistencies. And what I would do here is I would jump into the code and I would find and audit every single hex code you can find. So work with your front-end developers, find out how they're displaying colors, if they're using RGB or hex or a different system, and just scrape all of them, put them into a Figma file as little circles, and then just move them around. I would do this visually, and I would do this ideally on a MacBook because that's got the best color profile of any screen. And this is one which I did for a new product I was working on recently. And you can see there were so many shades which were so close, but were just off by one or two values. So we did this audit, and then I did this color scale exercise and manually just adjusted each shade so that when we rolled out these new color styles across the website, none of our users would have noticed a big change. This wasn't like a rebrand, but it just made everything a lot more coherent. And our front-end developers loved this because it just meant that everything was way easier. All of the labeling and naming structures were in place. And if we wanted to update something in Figma, we could just update it in one place in the code and that change would cascade out. So that's what you should do if you're adopting a product and you just need to move it to a place where everything's a little bit more systematic. Anyway, I hope you found this useful. If you're new here, please take a few seconds to subscribe as I've got loads more cool videos coming up. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.